Hi everyone, thanks for having me today. My name is Pierre. I'm a co-founder and CTO of a small cloud hosting company in Switzerland, which is why I'll be talking about cloud today. This isn't all too altruistic. I come from Switzerland, but from the French-speaking province, and I didn't pay too much attention to the German classes when I was a kid, so I'll be doing the talk in English. Apart from my work at Exascale, I'm also an open source developer, member of the OpenBSD team, and I now focus more on visibility tools such as CollectBSD Logic and Riemann, to name a few. And I also like working with distributed systems, which explains the line of work I'm in. And since this is a Linux forum, I've been using Linux since I think it was a 1.2.13 kernel back then. So the objective of my talk today is to give you how we approach scalability and how virtualized environments and the cloud really changes that. So Wikipedia, which is where I go for quotes most of the time, says that the scalability is the ability of a system, network, or process to handle a growing amount of work in a capable manner, or its ability to be enlarged to accommodate that growth. So basically, as things get bigger and bigger, you still manage to handle the work. And when we talk about scalability, especially in companies or in organizations, there are four main factors that come into play to be able to scale something. There's a whole, and sometimes the most important bits revolve around culture, as well as organization and process. But there is also a technical architecture part and an operations part. And today I'll focus on the latter. So the things I'll talk about is first some really rough overview, maybe old news to you, that define the different types of scalability that you may be confronted with. A bit of recent history and how things evolved on how we approach scalability. Then I'll try to define our notion of what the cloud is, because it's many things to many people. And then we'll look at what that means in terms of approaching development, but also architecture and infrastructure. So as I was saying, the cloud means many things to many people. But for the purposes of this talk, I'll conflate that with infrastructure as a service, because I might be a bit biased, but I still think it's one of the most important aspects of the cloud. I'll do that through the prism of web application design, even though you might apply these concepts to any type of development or approach to infrastructure, really. So to start off, very quickly, three types of approaches to scalability. The easiest one to understand is the vertical one, which is you just buy a bigger box and you run the same thing on it. That's usually how you do how you scale your MySQL instance. I mean, most of the time, that's how people approach that problem. You just buy a bigger box. Horizontal scaling is which is also called scaling out, is adding more nodes in a system to handle a bigger workload. It's not as easy as buying a bigger box would be, because it implies having some cooperation. But I think that one of the things that we're really accustomed to is to use this approach for our web application tiers, for instance, web servers, because if your free stateless web servers are not sufficient to handle your growth, you just add a two-behind load balancer, and that's it. That's usually the most, the simplest and easiest way to go about horizontal scaling. Most of the time, though, you end up doing a bit of both. You end up maximizing resources on a few nodes, and then adding nodes when that's not possible anymore. So that's about it really for the approaches to scalability. Now if we look at how things evolved over time, well, the initial response to scalability was to just wait, because the time for a machine that would handle the exact workload would come around and be cheaper than the one you already had, was usually smaller than the time you would have had to develop a new thing to work with the same box. So that worked well for quite a while. And whenever it's still possible, I'd say it's a great approach. And that's still something that people do today. When your puppet master is too slow, oftentimes you run into the box and then everything goes fine. But it's still something, we're still drawn to looking at alternative approaches now, and it's because this guy didn't tell us the whole story when he set out to edict the law that transistors would, capacity would double every 2 years. First it's every 2 years and a half now, but the one thing that really changed is that your average core speed didn't change much in the last 5 years. If you look at your laptops, most likely your core speed didn't change. What did change though is that you went from 1 to 4, maybe 8, on a laptop, and it's the same for servers that now have 40, 60 core systems. Which means that even on single systems, you have to think about scaling out workloads. Scalability is now not only a multi-node thing, but it also becomes a single-node thing, because you can't do everything on a single thread. And that makes things a bit harder. On the JVM, which has a nice support for threading, getting concurrency right is so difficult that there are now plenty of languages that try and solve that problem a bit more elegantly. Still using the JVM, but not using Java as the primary language. And in other more used languages for the web landscape, the threads are a thing that doesn't actually map to system threads unless you use particular tricks. So how do you approach scaling out your your workload then? What this means is that basically for most of the problems you're going to look at, horizontal is the way to go. And while this all happens, while this consistent increase in core per system happened, well, with projects like, the Linux world as well, at least projects like Zen and KVM become more and more mature and allowed to run multiple machines on a single one. And at some point, someone had the idea that it'd be nice to have an API behind that, and that's how we got around to having infrastructure as a service, really. So, to try and have a simple definition of what infrastructure as a service is, it's IT as a utility trying to make computers be a little bit more like electricity, having it easy to turn them on and off programmatically. There's an essential notion of decoupling system resources such as CPU and RAM from disk, to be able to dynamically scale workloads and still have this notion of local vertical scaling. And most of the time that's coupled, at least we believe it's essential, that's coupled with a pay-as-you-go model where you only pay for the resources that you use, not for the whole capacity that's allocated. So there are quite a few upsides to this approach. This takes capacity planning out of your hands. You don't have to think about calling the purchasing department to get a bigger box 6 months before, but the turnaround is around 10-15 seconds, so that's much nicer. The fact that you don't have this huge cost in in capital, but for buying boxes, usually smooths out the price of infrastructure, which is a nice thing, especially for companies that are starting up. And as someone leading a company that does this, I think no one really likes going to the data center and shuffling boxes around. At least we don't have to do it. But the other thing is that by having a programmatic approach to infrastructure, these somewhat complex concepts that you have to deal with when you deal with physical infrastructure, they can disappear, they can be abstracted away. You don't need switches anymore, you don't need to think in terms of VLANs or complex network addressing. You don't really need to look at OS partitioning or handling RAID. That's something that IT as a utility gives you. Instead, you get presented with this to handle your infrastructure, but most of the time as developers or as people working with infrastructure, you're rather working with something like this that gives you programmatic access to defining infrastructure in a simple way. Life's not all good though, there are still a few things. Deep down, it's still computers, and they still fail in mysterious ways sometimes, and we have to deal with this. And being in a virtualized environment with plenty of nodes means that you have to account for this. There's also a mental thing, because boxes and servers, they're easy to reason about. They're easy to touch, and that's what you've been working with for quite a while. So it's hard to change our mental model around this. It's also hard to change our trust model. It's hard to trust someone else to deal with your computers, because most of the time, you still like to be able to touch them. And it's not magic fairy dust either. It's actual hardware, so there is underprecise on the amount of RAM, on the amount of disk that you're gonna get on a single node, right? Which is why we're talking about this horizontal first approach to dealing with infrastructure. All right. A few more things. Dealing with distributed infrastructure, dealing with workloads that span several nodes, means that you're slowly entering the world of distributed systems, which come with their own rules and all compromises. First, as soon as you have two, you essentially have a distributed system, even though you might not have looked it that way, especially for the simple ones where you have a database and a web server. That's all right, but things tend to get more complex now. So sure, you're gonna reduce the amount of single points of failure in your infrastructure by scaling out, but you're also gonna augment the amount of failure scenarios that you have. And as you might know, any distributed system is subject to a mathematically proven theorem that says that out of consistency, availability, and partition tolerance, you can only enjoy two, and you have to choose, and you have to make that compromise and understand what it means. All right. So now that the landscape is set, the rest of my talk is delves a little bit more into the development world and looks at how to program for the cloud, really, and how by reducing complexity of software and by bundling in a few things, you're able to actually have software that's resilient and that may work on any type of infrastructure. So, a few things. I'll start with describing what I think, what I mean by inspectable services, by queues, how to handle failure rights in distributed systems, choosing components in an intelligent manner, and then looking at how configuration happens. And I'll start with inspectable services. So this is one of my, this is really one of the things I'm quite interested in. As I mentioned, as an introduction, I work on several monitoring projects, and I think that now it's more essential than ever to look at our systems, because they become increasingly complex. If you look at how we did things back in the early 2000s, most people had a web server with a funny name. They might have had a mail server, and then there was the database, right? So you had these three systems to reason about. Most people looked at maybe CPU, RAM, and disk metrics, and that was the extent of what you needed to do to assert that things went right. And if CPU went up on the web server, well, you know that maybe your CGI script was acting up. If it was going up on the database, you knew that maybe an index was missing on the SQL database. Now we tend to have these much more complex application stacks. You have a few applications, one in Python, one in PHP, one in Java, Ruby on Rails. They might be co-located on the same machines. The databases, you might have a bit of Elastic. I saw that someone from there was here. The talk just before me, the several MySQL ones, and even maybe Cassandra or more distributed one. To assert the fact that things work in such an environment becomes much harder, and you have to try and look at higher level metrics than just how's my CPU and RAM doing, because that's not telling you whether the application works or not. So one of the things I'm saying here is that an essential aspect of this is to try and build introspection right down in the services, so that you have higher level metrics that gives you an idea of whether your service is working or not. So that can be a number of acknowledge process mail requests, for instance, because when you have a spike in this, that's a good indication that something's going wrong. Timing actions within the system also gives you a good idea of whether you have hotspots coming up. This has to be done while avoiding the monitor effect, like running a four gig Java program that takes up all the heap on your machine. Just to know if things are working might not be the best approach, economically a bit unviable. So as much as possible, try and have small unobtrusive probes, and there are quite a few tools that do this. Again, here I'm a bit biased, but I think CollectD is one of these tools that helps you look at both system and also application metrics, and has very little overhead in resiliency. To ship out metrics, UDP is also something that that's often sufficient, and that puts very little strain on systems. As much as possible, writing monitoring solutions is not something I'd go for, because it's it easily becomes a full-time job. But there are quite a few proven tools out there that can help you build that part. And here, I'm showcasing how in code, how unobtrusive adding instrumentation to code can be. Another key factor in having resilient infrastructure is trying to prefer queues over RPC as much as possible. And this is because mostly RPC couples systems. As soon as one of your services cannot go on without having a response from an RPC system, then the compromises you have to make between consistency, availability, and partition tolerance, they become the worst one of either your service or the RPC it is coupled to. I think like taking responsibility out of the caller of an external system as soon as possible is really something that you should also strive for. And the real textbook example here is SMTP. As soon as an MTA within the many hubs that an email of yours might go through before going to its destination, as soon as an MTA says, okay, I'll deal with it from now on, your responsibility is over as a previous MTA. Also, queues, they help with statelessness, they help with retries, and it's much more easy to thread around a request ID through a system rather than do an RPC type action. And one of the really nice side effects of using queues is that it gives you a really nice way to dynamically shape the system. Say that you have a backlog that's growing, that's an easy thing to look at, like the size of the incoming queue. As soon as that becomes too big, well, adding workers to handle the additional workload helps in shaping the system and scaling only the part that you have a hotspot on. And that's it about it for queues. As far as handling failure, as possible, you have to, I think embracing the fact that software is not perfect, I hope that by now everyone is convinced of this, but the systems will fail, software will have bugs that are quite mysterious to look at, and you have to account for that from the get-go. And one of the ways to account for that is to try and avoid the impact of a failure, to avoid propagation. You can implement back pressure in systems, try and account for the fact that one of the services that again, queues here help a lot because they can act as that pressure valve for your back pressure. And as much as possible, avoiding having one thing being down, bringing everything down, can be interesting. If you have several storage layers, for instance, having the one where the accounts are being down might mean that new accounts cannot be created, but that existing workloads, existing pages, are whatever may still be served. And yeah, there are also approaches in libraries where by using connection pooling, by using retry policies, you're able within a set amount of time to try and really service a workload. Another thing is that when choosing the components you're going to depend on, ensuring that the components you're going to choose follow this approach and are components that are concerned production citizens is something that you should strive for, because any system that you choose will impact the compromises you have to make in your system. Or every new moving part, let's say that you reach out for MongoDB because it's convenient for this one thing that you need to do, then that's the properties of MongoDB are going to affect all of your system. So that's true of the things that you build yourself, that you write, infrastructure or application software that you write, but also of external components, databases, queuing systems, and so on. So yeah, choose components accordingly as much as possible. One of the examples I like to point out is that, for instance, when you choose a queue, it's not because you already have a database that it's a good candidate for a queue, right? There are solutions that are tailored for this approach and that help by not forcing bad compromises on you. And using MySQL as a queue is a nice way of ensuring years of consultancy on the infrastructure side, but it's not the best way to build resilient infrastructure, obviously. Having heap on machines when you scale out is really nice, but if all of your workloads depend on a centralized cache like a memcache or a Redis, and otherwise shoot through the roof in CPU usage, that means that you essentially in your infrastructure have a huge spot. So as much as you can try and disaggregate memory and cache locally using stuff like memcache or Redis as externalized heap and not only as centralized cache. I'm going over and over on this compromise thing, but there are different systems provide different properties. Object storage gives you somewhat high latency, high throughput, and eventual consistent storage. That's really great for your assets. That's great for your cold storage or backups. Things like this, distributed key value stores, they are usually eventually consistent as well. And by eventually consistent, I mean AMP, so they're available and partition tolerant. And SQL is the definition of consistent systems, usually at the price of both availability and partition tolerance. Now that logically speaking, we have a few drivers to build a resilient system, the next part is looking at how that system evolves with production and how to configure it. And as you work with environments which might have high node volatility, in the cloud node where you may need to spin up new nodes to accommodate for additional workloads, you don't want to be in the business of working in Puppet all day long or actually going to machines and editing config files to account for new machines. Having a centralized point of configuration where nodes come and register themselves is something that's essential. That's what we call service registries. And they help track of node volatility. They help in reprovisioning configuration when cluster topology changes. For instance, there might be a new host in your app server tier, and you want the load balancer to update configuration based on this. Load balancers actually are really good points of interaction for this. They can be the place where you deal with the service registry. And now, in the past 2 years, a few projects have emerged, which are basically small co-located load balancers that run on nodes that are called service meshes, but it's essentially load balancers, and that help you just reach out to local host and have just that software dealing with the service registry part, which is also quite convenient. Because it's going to keep track of load volatility, because it's going to keep track of configuration and distribute configuration changes, your service registry essentially becomes critical. So ideally, it should be a strongly consistent distributed thing. There are a couple I'll mention right after that. But if you don't want to bring a new component in your infrastructure, you already have a service registry that works quite well, and that's DNS. It's eventually consistent, it doesn't give you strong consistency guarantees, but it's super convenient and convergence times are usually quite low. I switched that, but two of the ones I'm mentioning here are Zookeeper and NCD. They're both best in class for as far as service registries are concerned. They help you deal with that node registration, but they also promote in-app usage to do things like leader elections, distributed buyers when all machines need to wait for a precondition, things like this. Here, I'll switch to immutable infrastructure, and which is a term I'm not super comfortable with because the contrarian approach wants that the immutable infrastructure is infrastructure that does nothing. But what we mean by that is that as much as possible, configuration drift should be avoided and replaced by spinning up new nodes, which is more convenient. The bulk of the idea is that as soon as you log onto a machine and start changing things, you're going to induce drift, and drift drives heterogeneity within clusters, which usually is a bad idea. So, as soon as you introduce drift, reprovisioning nodes becomes important. If new software is released, reprovisioning node is a nice approach, or even for configuration file changes, it can be a good approach. And coupled with that, I think one of the key messages of approaching distributed infrastructure is to try and use clusters as the base unit of reason. You don't want to be in the business. We're not in the business of naming our hosts with funny names anymore, but they should be identical nodes within the homogeneous cluster as much as possible. So that's about all I have for how to approach working and architecting for the cloud. A few things, these are somewhat, this is a talk I already gave. I say looking forward, but now it's, we're sort of in that space now. We all know about containers, and I think what they help is build a new abstraction layer that really uses infrastructure as a utility and gives you higher order concepts to deal with. They help build platform as a service solutions very easily, and I think that you can really say that they're a commodity now. OpenShift is a nice example that's been discussed here yesterday. But also, there are now orchestrators that help you encode knowledge about operations right in software, and two very interesting projects for that are Apache Mesos on one hand, and the concept of Kubernetes operators, which helps you encode your actual working knowledge of, you know, what happens when I have two databases and the master goes down. What event should happen and what procedure should be taken out, carried out. That really helps you deal with these distributed resources as a whole and build basically operating constructs for them. That's all I have. Thanks for having me, and I'll be taking any questions.
I have a question about the load balancer, because scaling out identical nodes is fine, but now there is this one single point of failure or not, which is the load balancer. So you also talk about load balancers as a registry for the configuration. So what do you think about a load balancer when you say load balancer? Is it a Linux machine or is it special hardware? And is there a capacity limit?
I tend to think of it as a Linux machine, but I'm again here a little bit biased. So there are, I think that's up to the infrastructure layer to give you ways to host a single load balancer on several. Several machines by sharing an IP, which basically is by doing any tasks on a single IP that's shared across machines, for instance, you have the ability to. That's, again, here I'm a bit biased because that's the notion that we push forward because that's available and that's something that you can do on Exascale. That's how we approach this.
And is the capacity limit of such a load balancer a big issue, or is it usually quite open-ended?
I think around 2008, 2009 is when this stopped being a problem. Back then we had like this Linux systems had trouble dealing with the high number of IRQs. Mm-hmm. Had this IRQ bowling that was a bit necessary, and where you needed to shoot up packets every now and then, and that limited your packet throughput. I actually, that's something I worked a lot on OpenBSD because I worked mostly on the load balancer there to try and get to that million packet per second boundary, which was a huge issue back then. And when you went out to specialized hardware such as F5 or whatever load balancers, but that limit completely. Is completely gone now. For several reasons. First, the IRQ handling and the way network drivers are written has changed, and we account for that. And layer 7 handling became much much better. And now, when we say load balancer, for most people, it doesn't even mean layer 3 or layer 4 balancing, but layer 7. Like, people tend to reach out to issue proxy. HTTP or HTTP termination in the last two subsystems, and no one has, and you can go to gigabytes type of workloads with this. So no, I don't think it's a barrier in